remember those brave men who perished in this place. Burford, 17th of May, 1649. This day, Cornet Thompson was brought into the churchyard, the place of execution. Death was a great terror to him, as unto most. Some say he had hopes of a pardon, and therefore delivered something reflecting upon the legality of his engagement and the just hand of God upon him. But if he had, they failed him. Corporal Perkins was the next. The place of death and the sight of his executioners was so far from altering his countenance or daunting his spirit that he seemed to smile upon both and account it a great mercy that he was to die for this quarrel. And casting his eyes up to his father and afterwards to his fellow prisoners who stood upon the church leads to see the execution, he set his back against the wall and bid the executioners shoot, and so died as gallantly as he lived religiously.
On my right, our first speaker, John Rees, is going to be speaking on civil rights in time of conflict. John is a writer and broadcaster and a long-time member of the NUJ. He's a co-founder of the Stop the Wall Coalition and a spokesperson for the People's Assembly. His book on the Levellers, The Leveller Revolution, will be published by Verso later this year. John, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Megan, thanks very much. What I want to do is I want to talk about the Levellers and civil liberties and the battles that we have about civil liberties today. But I want to do it by drawing your attention to one particularly important thing about the Levellers, maybe the most important thing that transmits itself from their history to our day today. And that thing is that they were the first political organisation. They were the first radical political organisation in history. They were the first group of ordinary people to bind themselves together, to collect subs, to hold public meetings, to petition, to demonstrate outside Parliament, to elect representatives in the regiments of the New Model Army, to put their point of view both to the government of the day and to the commanders of the New Model Army, and to sustain that kind of organisation over years in the middle of a revolutionary upheaval. And I say that right at the beginning because I think we often have a picture of civil liberties as if they were simply something which is enshrined in law, and which once they're enshrined in law, then the mass of sort of atomized and individual citizens in the society enjoy those rights under those laws. But to be honest, it's never been like that. It has never been the case that simply well-meaning legislators put into law liberal legal frameworks which allow citizens their freedom in respect of religion or in respect of politics or in respect of freedom of speech. Those liberties and those laws, important though they are, important to be attained, important to be defended once they are attained, have always been the product of organised political pressure, organised political activity from below. And the Levellers were the origin and experts at doing this. In a time when the population of this country was just over 5 million, they produced petitions in the numbers of 30,000 or 40,000. They had demonstrations outside Parliament of tens or twenties of thousands, which would be millions in today's population. So they invented the business of organised, collective, political petitioning, and the authorities of the day detested them for it. They were imprisoned for doing it. Their petitions and pamphlets were burnt by the common hangman in marketplaces and outside the Royal Exchange and in Westminster in London to deter anybody else from doing this. The secret presses from which those petitions and pamphlets were produced were raided by the authorities, broken up, and their printers jailed for their pains. And it's worth thinking that the people who originated the idea of freedom of speech, of the freedom to petition Parliament for redress, of the freedom to address your fellow citizens through a political pamphlet, that those rights were established by people who took those risks and endured those penalties for doing so. And we are still using those tools. In fact, you could argue that the technological revolution that we are living through has reinvented those tools. The Levellers didn't have change.org or 38 degrees. There wasn't a parliamentary website as there is now where you can start a petition and if you get 100,000 signatures, supposedly oblige the House of Commons to debate the issue. They didn't have those facilities, but let's be clear, we have those facilities, but they still need to be defended and they still need to be used. Look what has happened only in the last week to the 38 degrees petition, which called for the sacking of the BBC's chief political correspondent, Laura Kunzberg. Now that petition had 35,000 people sign it in a matter of days, but because of political pressure, 38 degrees decided to take that petition down. Now that should be a warning to us. That should be a warning that you cannot trust any corporation or any other organisation with the ability to do something as simple and elementary and democratic as sign a petition unless you have control over that process yourself, unless you are willing to protest. And I'm glad to say a number of other petitions have now been launched in response to the 38 degrees decision to take down that petition. And by the way, we have to be alert to some new dangers as well. And I would say that one of the new dangers in the political situation that we have to be aware of is that the political right are now willing to challenge our ability to organise in this way by using some of the arguments that the left has established over generations against us. Now, I think this came into politics at the beginning of the war on terror when we saw Cherie Blair and Laura Bush tell us that the reason that we had to invade Afghanistan was to liberate women. That was a moment where the political right started using an argument which the left had been responsible for to attack the left and to advance a right-wing argument. And I would say the same has been going on in recent weeks over the Laura Kunzberg petition, where people who 364 days of the year don't give a damn about fighting sexism or standing up for women use that argument to get rid of this petition, which had absolutely nothing to do with that in the first place. I would also say that the accusations used against the left in the Labour Party of racism, when these are people who for generations have been fighting against racism, in the teeth of opposition from people who are now making the accusation, who've done very little over the same period to combat racism in order to undermine the left. So there are always threats, sometimes new, sometimes old, but always threats to the ability of ordinary people to do the most elementary democratic things in this society. And it doesn't get more elementary than being able to sign a petition for redress over something that you regard as being politically amiss in the society in which you live. And that returns me to the question of political organisation, because in my view, one of the absolutely central threats to our civil liberties at the moment is the trade union bill which the Tory government is pushing through. There is absolutely zero chance of people in this country being able to defend their civil liberties if they cannot bind together in collective organisations which defend their almost elementary rights at work. This is fundamental. Trade union membership and effective trade union membership, including the right to take industrial action if the members of a union decide to do so, is the most fundamental civil liberty that we have, because it is only by strengthening that form of collective organisation that all the other forms of civil liberty can be protected. We all know that you will not have freedom of speech or freedom of publication or freedom of petition if there aren't mass organisations of working people who can collectively defend those rights. They do not exist in the abstract. They are not going to be the gifts of well-meaning legislators. They are the fruits of previous struggle, and they can only be defended by organisations capable of continuing that struggle today. That is one of the central lessons of the Levellers movement. They formed a political organisation, a collective political organisation funded and directed by ordinary people for the purposes of political change and political advance. There was one problem, however, which they couldn't confront and couldn't actually see clearly in the 17th century, but that we do have the ability to see clearly now. You see, in the great debate that took place at the end of the first civil war, in the English Revolution, the great debate at Putney in 1647, where the elected representatives, and this had never happened before, the elected representatives of the regiments of the New Model Army came face to face with their own commanders and with the MPs from Parliament to debate what kind of society they were going to live in, how democratic that society would be. There was a famous confrontation, probably the most famous lines that have come down to us from the English Revolution. I'm sure that many of you know them. That Colonel Thomas Rainsborough, who was the most senior officer of the New Model Army, to be a supporter of the Levellers, said in the course of those debates, and he was confronting Oliver Cromwell, and Oliver Cromwell's son, Commissary General Henry Art, and his son-in-law, he was confronting them in the debates about whether or not the franchise should be extended much more widely, perhaps universally, in that society. Whether or not the House of Commons should be or shouldn't be elected by universal franchise. And Rainsborough said in those debates that he could see no reason, let me see if I can quote it more or less exactly from memory, that the poorest he that is in England hath a life to live as much as the richest he. And I see no reason why a man should put himself under a government that he has not had a hand in choosing. Now that is, in many ways, the origin of democratic rhetoric in this society, the origin of the democratic proposals in the society, and that's what the Agreement of the People, which Rainsborough was speaking in favour of in the Putney debates, that was the document which the Levellers brought forward, which enshrined that idea. But in reply to him, less famous, but this was the reply to him by Cromwell's son-in-law, Henry Ireton. Ireton said, I'm opposing this idea of universal suffrage. And he said, the reason I do this, everything I say is because I have an eye to property. In other words, if we give you people the vote, if the poor get the vote, they will use the vote to take the property away from the rich. Now, actually, the Levellers didn't mean that. But you can see why a bunch of property owners thought that if you gave the poor the vote, they'd take the property away from the rich. Or as Oliver Cromwell put it in that debate, this all tends to anarchy. Now, we've had some decades, shorter than people think, but some decades of parliamentary democracy. And we know that actually it hasn't ended up with parliamentary democracy taking the property away from the rich. But we all know that with every year that passes and every decade that passes, where the rich and the corporations still have untrammeled economic power and we do not, it undermines the democracy that people hoped for would come out of universal suffrage. If you don't have power over the most important things in your life, which are sometimes, often, frequently, fundamentally, not those decided in Parliament, there are these questions. Will I have a job? How much will I be paid for my job? How hard will I have to work at my job? What will I produce in my job? What will it cost me to buy it back again when it appears on the shelves? Those decisions are economic decisions which are taken by an aristocracy of the corporations as unaccountable as the monarchy and the aristocracy were in the 17th century. The levellers couldn't answer that question. They could only pose that question. But we can answer that question. We can say that we won't have fully democratic societies. We won't permanently and without fear of them being taken away be able to enjoy civil liberties until we can extend democracy from the political realm into the economic realm as well. And if you want a short definition of socialism, that's always been my definition. Democracy extended from politics into economics. That there was, in the 17th century, for a brief period, a republic, and people in this country did what no other people anywhere on the globe in previous history had ever done. They put their king on trial for treason against the people, and they executed him when they found him guilty in a court of law. In the entire history of kings and kaisers and czars and shahs and caesars, no people had ever done that before. I think that that's an inspiration for us to say that the aristocracy of finance, that the monarchy of the corporations has had its day, and that democracy needs to take another step forward. And perhaps we should take one more moment of inspiration from the levellers. Perhaps from the leveller who was the leader of the mutiny when it reached Burford in 1649. A man called Captain William Ayres. He'd been part of the Ware mutiny before that. He was part of the Burford mutiny. He'd been part of the Republican and Regicide, Henry Martin's regiment of levellers, which stormed around the Berkshire countryside in 1649, expropriating the horses of the local aristocracy, much to their irritation. And he was the only person actually in Burford. The Cromwell's troops attacked the mutineers in Burford in the middle of the night. He was the only person to actually exchange fire with the Cromwellian troops as they attacked down Burford High Street that night. He said this. He said, "I stand by my cause." He said, "If there were only 10 people that appeared for this cause, I would make an 11th.
Thank you very much, John. I must just comment on your mention of the proportionality of the activity. I think the nearest thing we've seen recently was in Iceland, following the Panama Papers, when 10,000 people gathered outside Parliament in a population of 300,000, which was quite extraordinary. Thank you so much. And just to prove that I'm in an NUJ sandwich, our next is Adrian Arbib. He's a photojournalist, worked all over the world for UK and international newspapers covering human rights issues. He's recently involved and working with the NUJ in trying to get information that the Metropolitan Police are keeping on journalists. Adrian, you're welcome.
Yeah, I'm going to sort of tell you a story that happened to me locally, not too far away in Abingdon. A few years ago, NPower were dumping fuel ash in some lakes, at Radley Lakes, and I went down there to cover it as a journalist, as a photographer. And it kind of woke me up to where we are with our civil liberties in the press and in this country. It was a big wake-up call for me. NPower had placed an injunction on the entire area so that anyone who went there was basically breaking the injunction and could go to jail. So as a newspaper reporter, I was filing for The Guardian and for BBC Wildlife at the time, keeping an eye on the story. I got a phone call from the locals and said, "Look, get down there quickly. They're cutting down a kingfisher's nest, which is a protected species under the EU Habitats Directive. Another reason to stay in Europe." And I photographed it. But within a few minutes of me photographing it, a bunch of guys turned up in balaclavas and a lawyer. I don't know where the lawyer came from, heaven knows, but a huge pile of bundle of page. I've actually got a photograph of the guy here. It's extraordinary. I don't know if you can see it, but that's what it looks like when you're a photographer on site. And so the lawyers then gave me this injunction and said, you know, if you continue photographing it, you're going to go to jail 5 years, breaking a high court injunction. And I carried on filming. I then got home, didn't really know what to do. Stuck the video up on YouTube of this guy doing giving this injunction, and got in touch with the NUJ, who were fantastic. And they said, well, you know, first thing you do is you get the video off YouTube because you're basically breaking the injunction, and let us deal with it. Now it's not that easy with YouTube because it takes 24 hours. Well, at that time, it took 24 hours to get rid of the video. So I had broken the injunction and I was in breach. So I was potentially facing 5 years in jail. I then got in touch with a friend of mine who's another photographer. He also helped me with this, and he said, well, what we'll do is we'll actually, you know, we'll take these guys to court, we'll get the NUJ involved. We challenged it, and we challenged it in the High Court, and we won. And it was a huge case, because basically what it's saying is an injunction, if it's in the public interest and the corporation is actually breaking the law, if they're breaking the law, you have a higher interest in this. And thank God for the NUJ, that's all I can say. Because if I was on my own, I probably would have crumbled. And it was terrifying at the time. So that's the story about Radley Lakes. And the good story is that finally they stopped dumping fuel ash in the lakes. And the story is it's now a beautiful wildlife site, largely because of the protest. Yeah. So where we go from carrying on from here, it's not just Radley Lakes, there's loads of these things happening all over the country. People are terrified of the state. They're absolutely terrified of it. Protesters, Little England, we might all here, we might be fairly hardened to protest. We might understand, you know, you can stand up to the state, but a lot of places are terrified. If you look at what's happening with the fracking sites, people for the first time in their lives are coming up against some horrible, horrible legislation. They're being terrified by brutalising policing. So as a journalist, and I've been covering a lot of this stuff, one of the things I wanted to find out was what information are they holding on journalists? Because when I covered the Radley Lakes incident, I managed to get some of the footage onto Panorama. And the editor, one of the producers said to me at the time, we didn't really want to use all your footage, and we're certainly not going to pay you for the footage, even though that she knew I was working for the NUJ. She said, you're a protester. And I said, well, I'm not a protester, I'm actually a photographer. I'm a member of the NUJ, I've filed for the Guardian, I've been a photographer for 25 years, and you know, I've been all over the place. I've taken pictures of Ivana Trump, I've taken pictures of you know, just crazy stuff that photographers have to do in the sort of schizophrenic journalism world. And basically, she was saying, you're a protester, we're not going to accept your footage as rogue. And this is happening a lot. This is happening a lot to people. That people are sending their footage in and then saying, well, you're not a bona fide journalist. Now, how do they know I'm not a bona fide journalist? What makes them assume that? So a group of us, myself, Mark Thomas, the comedian Mark Thomas, David Hoffman, about two or three other guys, Jess Hurd and Jason Parkinson, we applied to the Met to get information on what the police are holding on us. And you can do this, you pay them £10 and say, can you please release the data that you've got on file on us? And they sent me this very, very short and sweet bit of data which they had on me, where I had been identified photographing some buildings at Heathrow Airport for an article which I was doing on apples at Heathrow. So they identified me there. But then they also just says Mr. Arbib is a known environmental protester, and Mr. Arbib appears to be a professional photographer with an interest in the environment. So that's what had happened. The police had been offered the footage by Panorama. Panorama said, look, can you comment on this, because they've made allegations about the police. The police then say, well, look, Mr. Arbib's a known environmental protester. We've got it on our records. So that's how the press works these days. So what we're seeing in this country is a corporate media running the entire show. A lot of the journalists are too terrified to write stuff because they'll lose their jobs. The freelancers are too terrified because of this, and they're being cut out. As I rest my case, this is exactly what happened with Radley Lakes. You know, my footage was not used fully. I was not trusted by the corporate media. So we've got basically a complete self-editing going on within the newspapers because the editors are too frightened to confront anyone. And then we've got the freelancers themselves who are basically being shut up. And it's a very dangerous state of play. Now, I'd also bring you on to something else I found, which was the Reporters Without Borders. We slipped down from 19th in the World Press Freedoms to number 38. We were actually below China, Chile and Ghana. And we're only just marginally above China. So it's pretty worrying, actually. And this is based on data. This is to do with grabbing data from journalists and also intimidation of journalists. This is what's based on those facts. And so I think we don't realise quite how bad it is here. We are slipping into some very dangerous times, particularly with the current state of play we've got going on with freedoms generally. We've got regulatory investigatory powers, which the police allow authorisations to phone records. And since 1984, the police can ask courts, get a court order to hand over any unpublished material, source material. I mean, there's constant challenges going on. The NUJ are on it. But, we are living in times where we can be tipping over very, very quickly into some very dangerous places. I've worked in a lot of countries with repressive regimes. And one would think, well, it's not that bad here, really. But when you actually come down to key things, there are some very dangerous things at play here. I mean, if you look at things like anyone to do with, if you're going to fly in the face of government policy like fracking or anti-nuclear, and you really start digging, they're going to come down on you like a ton of nails. And it's only things like people power and being clever, like what happened at Radley Lakes, that we can actually shine these little lights, these like modern day levelers, to stand up against. A state that's is slightly running riot on things at the moment. I could go on for an awfully long time about this, but I'm not going to. I'm going to hand it over to him if you've got any questions, I think. But thank you very much.
Thank you.